Hey, welcome to Return of the King. This is a series where we're going chapter by chapter through the book of Revelation to see what the Bible really has to say about the last days. Hey, I'm Randy Bond. I've been a pastor for over 25 years, and our church has been going through Revelation this year. And I'm so glad that you're joining us today. Today, we are looking at a hugely important chapter in the book of Revelation, and that is Revelation chapter 5. And this is where we see the revelation of the Lamb and the scroll. This is part of a larger unit. Chapters 4, 5, and 6 all seem to be really tightly connected, where we see the throne of God in Revelation chapter 4. And we talked about that in one of our previous episodes, and you can find that link right here. And today we're looking at the Lamb. And then in chapter 6, we really get the full disclosure about the scroll. The scroll is introduced in chapter 5, so we'll talk about that a little bit today. But we'll see more about that in chapter 6. And you can find that episode right here. It's actually in three different parts that we've looked at. So I hope that you'll catch all of those and get a deeper dive into the contents of the scroll and the events that that sets in motion. Hey, as we're jumping in today, certainly if you have any questions or comments, I hope that you'll leave those below. And if you find anything useful or this episode gives you anything to really think about, something new, if you like it, I hope that you'll give it a like, a thumbs up there. And if you want to follow more of what we're doing and don't want to miss anything, make sure you subscribe and hit that notification bell. And that just means a lot to me. It's a free thing to do, and it's really encouraging when you do it. So thank you in advance. Let's jump right into Revelation chapter 5. Again, I'm reading from the English Standard Version. You can follow along in your translation. ESV is what I've got right here. So let's dive into God's word. Revelation 5, verse 1. Then I saw in the right hand of him who was seated on the throne a scroll written within and on the back, sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the scroll and break its seals?" And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look into it. And I began to weep loudly because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or to look into it. And one of the elders said to me, "Weep no more. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals." And so we are introduced here to the scroll of destiny. In verse one, we see that this is in the right hand of him who sits on the throne. If you missed chapter four, you're not really familiar. Just a real quick recap. Chapter four is this glimpse of heaven. John is able to have this heavenly vision. The very first thing that he sees is the throne and the one seated on it. And so we see the glory of heaven, we see the glory of God in heaven. And we see the worship of God in heaven. We're going to talk more about the worship of God. It's one of the critical components of the book of Revelation. So I hope that you'll stay tuned for that third part in today's, because a lot of people just kind of skim past the worship part, but it's really, really important. And I'll tell you why later. But we are introduced to more of the structure of heaven, angelically speaking. We see the four living creatures around the throne. Then we see the 24 elders around them. And then we have the myriad of angels that we'll see in chapter five here. But those are kind of the three key people and people groups, if you will. So God, the four living creatures, and those around the throne, the 24 elders. So as we get into chapter five, what we're shown a little bit more is that God is holding a scroll in his right hand. And there's going to be some key descriptors about the scroll that are critically important, that each one of the things, the descriptions about the scroll actually reveals something super important about what's really happening here. So first off, the scroll is in God's right hand. Right hand is always the place of strength. It is the place of power, if you will. And so this is in fully in God's control. And what we also understand is that he is the author of the contents of the scroll. So what is really being signified by this is that he controls the beginning and the end. He's been worshiped in chapter four as being eternal, as being holy, and then as being creator. So that creator aspect is very important as we're looking at the rest of the book of Revelation, because we need to understand who is in charge. And this is why these two chapters in particular, Revelation 4 and 5, are such a foundational component within the book of Revelation, because things are about to get really dark and really scary, but we need to understand who's controlling everything. And so we need to understand that God is in control, even when everything seems to be out of control. Now, as I am recording this today, and many of you are going to be watching this, we are just about a month out or less from the US elections. And it's kind of crazy to see what's happening there. But what we understand is that no matter who sits in the White House, we know who sits on the throne, and we know who is bringing everything to its rightful conclusion. And so this is an important part to understand. The scroll of destiny, God controls the destiny of the world, not people, not governments, not circumstances. Secondly, we see that the scroll is written inside and on the back. This is a highly unusual description for a scroll. Scrolls were often made out of papyrus, reeds, and so you would have these ribs in there, these veins. And typically, it was written on the front side. The front side, the veins would go horizontally. On the back, they would be vertical. And it was a whole lot harder to write on the back with those vertical kind of lines there. So most scrolls are only written on one side, as you can kind of see with this one, where it meets the sticks on the sides. You can see the back. There's no writing on that. This is an unusual thing. And so the very fact that there's writing on the back tells us a little bit that is meant to be understood here. That what is going to happen at the end is already determined in full. There's no room to add anything else. God has already fully determined what will happen at the end. There will be no surprises to God. It may be surprising to us, but there are no surprises to God about what's going to happen at the end. What's being indicated here by the scroll having the writing on the front and back. Everything is set, and it will be set in motion when the Lamb opens the seals in chapter 6. So we can take full confidence that no one can alter or change what is happening. And that's what we see with the seven seals. Seven is that number of completion, divine completion throughout Scripture. And so what we're understanding is that not only is everything determined in full, no one can alter the contents or set the things in motion except the worthy one. And we're about to find out who that worthy one is. This is two really important theological points, is that God's already determined it. No one can change it. So there's not going to be some kind of superpower or super government or anything like that that can alter God's plan. It's already set and no one can change that. The fourth thing is that we hear this surge in the cosmos. And that search is looking for the one who is worthy to open the scroll. And what this search reveals is that there's only one worthy to open the scroll and bring the world to its rightful conclusion. So again, here is the good news. There is no angelic being that can open and alter and change or set things in motion prematurely, the events that are lined out in the end. Only the one who is worthy can do that. And good news is, he's a good one. So in verses 2 and 3, here is where we have that revealed. He says, "And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming with a loud voice, 'Who is worthy to open the scroll and break its seals?' And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look into it." So not even to get a peek of the things except for the one who is worthy. And then we get the great news. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. So verse 5 says, "And one of the elders said to me, 'Weep no more.'" We have John weeping at this, that there's no one worthy. It doesn't mean that the one who is worthy is not there. He is present. It has just not yet been disclosed who that is, to give opportunity really to explore the fullness of creation, the heavens, the earth, and under the earth, to say that no one is worthy. And so John weeps over this and this exploration, if you will, to find the worthy one. Now we have the worthy one about to be revealed. And so this mighty angel says, "Weep no more. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals." So we have really these two key descriptors here of the worthy one. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He is the root of David. These are clearly messianic terms that are being applied to the worthy one. So we hear that Lion of the tribe of Judah, in Genesis 48, going all the way back to the first book of the Bible, verses 9 and 10, Judah is a lion's club. From the prey, my son, you have gone up. He stooped down. He crouched as a lion and as a lioness. Who dares rouse him? The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until tribute comes to him, and to him shall be the obedience of the peoples. So this lion of the tribe of Judah has always been understood as being the Messiah. So all throughout the Old Testament period, Jewish people have been looking for the lion of the tribe of Judah, and this is who is the worthy one. The other is this root of David. This comes from Isaiah 11, 1. There shall come up from, shall come forth a shoot from the stump of David, and a branch from his roots shall bear fruit. You can also see this in 11:10, so just a few verses later. Paul quotes this passage, and he says, and again, Isaiah says, the root of Jesse will come, and he who arises to rule the Gentiles, in him will the Gentiles hope. Here is one of the incredible and wonderful aspects that we see about the root of David. He is not just the lion of the tribe of Judah or just the Jewish people. He is also the root of Jesse, the root of David, who the Gentiles find their salvation, in whom they find their hope, and he will rule over us just as he will the Jewish people. And that is incredibly good news for us who have no Jewish blood in us. So this is the great hope. Now, who is this root of David? Well, Jesus tells us. If there's any question, and I have to go deep enough into this because surprisingly, I had a comment on one of my previous videos that claimed that the lamb was someone else. And that's rather interesting. And so at the very end of Revelation 22, 16, I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify to you about these things for the churches. I am the root and the descendant of David, the bright morning star. So if there was any question in anyone's mind, the lion and of Judah and the root of David, they're one and the same, and this is Jesus. So let's just be real clear. Scripture's clear. And so we want to be clearly understood that Jesus is indeed the lion of Judah, the root of David, the only one worthy to open the scroll. So John hears, behold, the lion of the tribe of Judah. He hears that the lamb has conquered. But then there's this interesting twist. And the question is here intentionally, what did he see? Because he hears one thing and he sees another. By the way, this is an interesting tool that John uses in his revelation later in chapter 7. We're going to see the same kind of formula where John hears one thing and then he sees the fulfillment of this, the fuller understanding. So there are both pieces are intended to go together to give the full understanding. What he hears is truth. What he sees is going to be a deeper understanding of that truth. So yes, indeed, Jesus is the lion of the tribe of Judah, the conquering one. However, he's also the lamb that was slain. Look at verse 6. And I saw between the throne and the four living creatures that are there and the elders, a lamb standing as if slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the world. So John sees a slaughtered lamb. And that's actually the word in the Greek is slaughtered. It's a very challenging word today for many of us. So not just that idea of slain, it's that brutal slaughtering. And so Jesus conquered through his death. This is an important reality for the book of Revelation. So we want to be careful not to measure victory by the world's terms. The world is seeing they conquered Jesus, they killed him. But in reality, he conquered the world, he conquered Satan, he conquered death through death. And in Revelation 12, 11, we see the same kind of thing played out in the people of the Lamb. And it says, and they have conquered him, the beast, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, for they love not their lives even unto death. And this is one of those key understandings that we need to have in the book of Revelation, is that victory is not measured by by guns and weapons and so forth, and it's not by living or outliving until the end. It may even be through weakness, where the world would see it as weakness, or even our death as the ultimate weakness, that we find the ultimate victory. The second thing that we see about this lamb, he is the sacrifice. He has conquered through death. He is the one who has purchased people for God through his death. But there's a strange description that he has seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God. So we have a definition of that second part, and we'll get to that. But before we go there, if you're of age, you may remember the old Calvin and Hobbes comic strip. I love that as a kid, and still enjoy reading that from time to time. But if you'll remember, he had this box that he called the transmogrifier. And that's where he would set the dial. You can see on the left side of the box, and he would go in as a little boy, and he could set that out and come out in his great imagination, and he would have been transformed, transmogrified into an eel, baboon, bug, or dinosaur in this case. So it was always kind of humorous to see how he set the dial and what he would come out as. I always thought that transmogrified was just something, a word that Bill Watterson, the artist for the comic strip, had just come up with, a very humorous word. It's actually a real word. And it means to change or alter greatly, and often with grotesque or humorous effect. And I put all this here, not just as a little distraction, but as an important theological point. Jesus was not transmogrified into a seven-eyed lamb. He is not literally a sheep. He does not literally have seven horns and seven eyes. We have a lot of symbolism. Jesus is being portrayed here. He may have manifested in this way for the purpose of John to be able to see this, but it's really more about the symbolism than it is about trying to have a literal description of what Jesus looks like here. Again, this is one of those things that in the comments of some of the previous videos, some people are a little bit confused on this. They think that Jesus literally is a sheep, that he has been transmogrified from a human to an animal. And that is not what Revelation is revealing. Revelation reveals some strong theological realities about Jesus. And we need to grab onto that because they're hugely important, as you'll see as we go along. And I say this because he is still in his resurrected human body. Philippians chapter 3, verses 20 and 21 reminds us our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who, Jesus, will transform our lowly bodies to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him to subject all things to himself. Jesus was literally, physically, bodily resurrected from the grave. It was not just a simple spiritual kind of thing, and the people saw a phantom. If you remember the post-resurrection accounts, he was very tangible, very physical. You have this great painting of Thomas sticking his finger into the wound. We don't know that he actually physically touched him, but he was touchable. Jesus invited the disciples, the apostles, to touch him, and he ate fish in front of them on more than one occasion. So he was physically, bodily raised from the grave. And when he ascended bodily, physically. He did not magically, mysteriously lose that body in the ascension. Remember, the angel said, you will see this same Jesus come in the same way that he has gone in Acts chapter 1. And so there is no indication in Scripture that Jesus has somehow lost his humanity. This is part of the incredible aspect of the incarnation, is that he is still fully God and fully man, and he still possesses that resurrected physical body. And no, 1 Corinthians 15, the verse that says flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, is not a proof that he has lost his physical body. In the context, it's talking about our resurrection. And if resurrection is really temporal and temporary, why have it? And so in this, what our blessed hope is looking forward to is the full salvation of our humanity, that we were intended to be physical human beings. and we will remain physical human beings. And Jesus has joined us in the incarnation so that we have a sympathetic high priest who understands who we are, what we are, and he is proud to call us brothers, Book of Hebrews in a nutshell. And this is the incredible thing. So I say a lot of that because there is some confusion out there about that, but scripture is not confused about this. Jesus did not lose his physical resurrected body. He still has his resurrected human body. So Jesus is not a sheep. All that is intended to do is point us to some theological realities. It's intended to symbolize some truths. So what do we really see about Jesus in this? Number one, he is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. So the strength, power, this is that messianic term. He is a lamb standing as if it was slain. We see sacrifice. He conquered through weakness. He has his seven horns. Seven, again, number of divine completion. He has everything, horns, symbol of strength, of power. He is all powerful. He has all authority. Seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God. He is all knowing. He is all wise. He has that deep, intimate connection, that unity with the Holy Spirit. So interestingly, if you look at this, Jesus is actually portrayed here in Revelation 5 in all three of his messianic roles. He is indeed portrayed as the king, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He is also portrayed as the priest. We see really the sacrificial part of this, but we see from Hebrews 8 and 9, he is the one who offered also this perfect sacrifice. So he is both the perfect sacrifice and the perfect high priest to offer that sacrifice. And he is also a prophet. So prophet, priest, and king are those three messianic roles that no human possessed in the Old Testament, but we see fully encapsulated in Jesus and Jesus alone. And so this spirit of prophecy that we see, this deep connection with the Holy Spirit is all three of these that are rolled into the one. Now, third part here, worship in the throne room. Folks, don't rush past the worship in Revelation. We have five hymns in chapters 4 and 5 alone. And worship throughout the book of Revelation, not just here, is used, number one, to connect and to remind of important theological realities. So when events are happening and there's worship, there may be a connection to the reality of who God is, to the events that are happening. And all of that is intended to be a source of strength and encouragement for us. The second thing is that sometimes worship is actually used to explain what is happening. So when the seventh trumpet is sounded, we see in Revelation chapter 11, 15 and 16, then the seventh trumpet angel blew his trumpet and there were loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. And the 24 elders who sit on the thrones before God fell on their faces and worshiped God. And the next few verses are the record of the worship, and it is explaining the events that are happening more clearly and give us clarity about what is happening with the seventh trumpet. So worship is incredibly important. So don't just rush past, they're worshiping, blah, blah, blah. Take time to meditate on that worship. Take time to process with that worship, why it is here in this particular passage in Revelation, and let it drive you to worship. The book of Revelation is not intended to be just a code book that we figure out. That is the least, at least of all possibilities of the book of Revelation. It is intended to drive us to worship, drive us to understand more fully who God is, who Jesus is, to worship him, to serve him confidently, to serve him with endurance all throughout. So there's a whole lot more to Revelation that we tend to overlook. So don't overlook the worship. So let's examine the worship here. So starting in verse 7, it says, when he, the Lamb, Jesus, took the scroll, went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who was seated on the throne. And when Jesus had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth. So let's take a look at the Revelation chapter 4. So let's do a little bit of a recap on the worship there. The first hymn that is recorded is the Holy, Holy, Holy. It is holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. The second hymn is worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things. Don't miss that. And by your will, they existed and were created. Everything has been created by God. So let's talk a little bit more about the worship that we see in Revelation 4. Hymn number one, who is worshiped? God is the one who sits on the throne. Who is worshiping? In this case, the four living creatures initiate the worship, and then it's followed by the 24 elders. They join into the worship that the four living creatures initiate. And how do we see them worshiping? By saying, holy, holy, holy. Not necessarily singing, but by saying. And then we see the 24 elders. They get off of their thrones. They fall down before God. Notice that action. That's an important action that we need to understand as we get into chapter 5. This is that prostrating before God. It is that show of humility before him, that reverence that they give to God. It is an act of worship. And they cast their crowns before him. So if you have ever wondered, where does that expression casting crowns come from? It's here. And that's what we see is an act of worship, the symbol of authority that they have, the symbol of victory that they have. This is what they take as that reward and place before the throne in an act of worship. And again, they also speak. They're saying the words. And so just kind of a side note here, worship is not limited to music and singing. So when you go to church, and you should be, if you're physically able to, worship is not just the song part. Sometimes in some churches, you'll see people standing for the worship and they stand for all the songs. And I just did it right there. that the music is kind of seen as the only part of worship. And then just kind of sit down and maybe even will drink their coffee as though they're being entertained by the rest. Listen, the prayer at the very beginning and throughout, that's all worship. The reading of God's word is worship. The listening to his word being taught is worship. As we take that in, as we hear the word, and as we change our lives by the word, and as we put that into practice and are obedient to the word, the offering that is taken up, that is clearly an act of worship. Whether a plate is passed or there's some way to do it in the back or you give online, all of those are acts of worship. So it's not just the singing part, it's every aspect, hopefully, within your worship service that is an act of worship. So what is God worship for? This is the what's driving the worship. And it's also important for us as these are the theological realities about who God is. All true worship is based in theological truth. You cannot worship God by what you wish God was like. You worship God because of who he has revealed himself to be. Any other thing aside from truth is simply idolatry. And you're creating mental images, if not molten images of God, and that's just idolatrous. But the theological basis of the worship is timely and important. So why is he worshiped here? Number one, and hymn number one, it's because of his holiness. Everything God does is good and right. This gives us great hope for the days ahead, that no matter how difficult they get, no matter how dark they get, no matter how much evil seems to have its day, God is absolutely good and right in allowing those things to happen to bring it to his proper end, and we can trust him that he is not doing anything wrong to us or anything wrong against us. All of this is good and right that's about to happen. And so here are some of the understanding the heart and the character of God. Second is his eternality, that he alone exists outside of time and he controls the events throughout time. Another one of those aspects. So this is the holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty who was and is to come. This is that eternal kind of statement that he has never had a beginning, will never have an end. He is the only one who exists that way. And time is nothing to him. I mean, he controls time and the events of time ultimately. Third, he is the creator. That was that second hymn. You remember, I called that out. Everything was created by him. All the angels were created by him, including the fallen angels. And he is able to use fallen angels even for his purpose. Remember that thorn in the flesh that Paul has? It's called a messenger of Satan that was sent by God to keep Paul humble. So God can use even the fallen angels, the demons, for his glory, for his purpose. They are ultimately subject to him, and he will bring them to their right and proper end at the right time. So all of this, all of creation, the world that we live in, planet Earth, is his, and he controls the destiny. So things are not running out of control. He's not sitting in heaven stressing over, man, how's this going to play out in the end? We may be, but he is not. And then let's move over to chapter 5. And when we get here, we see some incredible truth about Jesus. If you miss the Jesus of Revelation, you've missed the point of Revelation. And here in chapter 5, we see the worship of Jesus in heaven. And that tells us a lot about who he is. Hang on tight. Hymn number 3, Worthy Are You. Remember, this is where they have fallen down before the Lamb. And if you have any questions, just listen to the content of this, that this is Lamb directed. This is Jesus directed. Worthy are you to take the scroll, to open its seals, for you were slain, clearly Jesus, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation, and you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth. Now, there's a whole lot more in there, but notice those key things about he is the Redeemer, the one who has ransomed us by his blood. Hymn number 4, Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Again, his worthiness is tied to this obedience, even unto death, as Philippians 2 discusses, to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. We'll talk more about that in a moment. And then hymn number 5, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever. So again, just like we did in chapter 4, let's talk about who was worshiped. In hymns number 3 and 4, it's the Lamb. It's Jesus who is being worshiped. Hymn number 5, it's to him who sits on the throne, speaking of God the Father, and the Lamb. Both the Father and the Son are worshiped equally. So notice that in all three of the chapter 5 hymns, the Lamb is the object of worship. In hymn number 5, it's a shared worship between the Father and the Son, but notice that the hymns 3 and 4 are exclusively to the Lamb. Now, this is important. Remember rule number 1 in heaven, worship rule number 1 in heaven. Worship is for God alone. In Revelation 19, there's this odd moment where the angel has been revealing some incredible things to John. And John, for whatever crazy reason, maybe because the angel resembles Jesus because of the close connection there and because of the words that have been saying, John confuses the angel and begins to worship him. So listen to this moment. It says, and the angel said to me, write this, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Amen. And he said to me, these are the true words of God. Verse 10, then I fell down at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, you must not do that. I am a fellow servant with you and your brothers who hold to the testimonies of Jesus. Notice this, worship God. For the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Rule number 1 in heaven, only God is worthy of worship. Only God gets worship. When angels are worshiped, and by the way, we are not to worship angels. Very, very clear right here. We are not to pray to angels. We are not to worship dead humans. We're not to pray to dead humans. We have direct access to the throne of grace by the blood of Jesus. And it is an insult to Jesus to direct our prayers to anyone else. All the angels understand this. If you are in an encounter with an angel and you worship them and they accept that, you know you don't have a true angel of God there. Run away and repent of your idolatry. But very clearly, angels understand only God gets worship. And when that worship is misdirected at them, they don't brush it off. They correct the worshiper and move it to the right direction. This tells us a whole lot about the Lamb. So who is worshiping in hymn number 3? It's the four living creatures and the 24 elders, those who are closest to God, who understand who God truly is, who is worthy of worship. They are worshiping the Lamb. In hymn number 4, we now have an uncountable multitude of angels to stress all the angels have now joined in the worship in hymn number 4. In hymn number 5, now we see this broadened out to every created thing in heaven, on earth, under the earth, and in or on the sea. And so this is kind of given that wholesale worship, that preview of everything worshiping, every created thing, angelic, human, and otherwise, giving the rightful worship to the Lamb and to the one who sits on the throne. How are they worshiping? In this case, they sing a new song. And just kind of a side note here, when it's time to sing and worship, sing. We sing because God is good, not because we sing good. So don't hold your voice back. You might tone it down a little bit, not to be a distraction if you're like me and can't sing very well. But don't just be silent. God is worthy of your song. He is worthy of your singing. So bring that out. When you're in church and it's time to sing, sing out and sing with gusto. So note that in this worship, in chapter 5, the four living creatures and the 24 elders give approval to the worship of the Lamb by continually saying, amen. And that's in verse 14. That there's no question in their mind about the worthiness of Jesus to be worshiped. By the way, that's what the word worship means. Worship means to ascribe worth. It's from that old English worthship. And that's an important thing, because that word that we see throughout Revelation 4 or 5 is the word worthy. Worthy are you, the one who sits on the throne. Worthy is the Lamb. So remember, again, that worship rule number 1 in heaven, worship God. Only God gets worship. So Revelation 5 clearly reveals that Jesus is God and worthy of worship. By the way, if you want a little bit deeper dive on that, I've got another video, and I'll leave the link up here. Is Jesus God, and how Revelation 5 really does point to that. And there's a couple of others. Is Jesus Jehovah? So just looking at the divinity of Christ and a couple of different videos there, and we encourage you to look at that, particularly if you have been talking to people who don't believe in the deity of Jesus, Jehovah's Witnesses or Muslims or others who may not believe this. This might help you in your conversation with them. So hope that you'll watch that and let me know what you think about that. So again, back in the worship in chapter 5, what is Jesus worship for? He was slaughtered. The word in many translations is slain, but he was literally slaughtered for us, that he purchased men from all types of people for God, every nation, every tongue. And that's the beauty. It is a global gospel. It is global good news. Third, and he makes them a kingdom and priests to reign upon the earth. That's one of the constant themes throughout the book of Revelation. We see that the people of God, the saints of God, are the priests of God, and they are a kingdom of God. Now, what is Jesus worthy of? Verse 12 in chapter 5, he's worthy of power, riches, wisdom, might, honor, glory, and blessing. Notice that in chapter 7, verse 12, Jesus is ascribed the same worth, the same honor, as God in Revelation 7. So in Revelation 7, on the right-hand side there, these are the things that the one who's seated on the throne, what God is worshiped for: blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. So notice that all of these are the same words, that what the Father is worthy of, The Son is equally worthy of. So this is not just a diminished worship of the Lamb, but that's okay. He's a created God, and so he's kind of worthy of a worship that's less than God. No, no, no. There is only one God. Scripture's clear on that. And only God is worthy of worship. And we see the people doing the same thing in heaven for both, that they are falling down before the throne. They are falling down before the Lamb. They are worshiping. They are saying worthy. And here are the things you can see. They are exactly worthy of the same things. The only thing that we see different is that the Lamb is worthy of wealth. The Father is worthy of thanksgiving. Now, why these two would be different, I don't know. But that's the only point of difference between the two. Jesus is worthy of the same worship as the Father to no less degree. He's not only worshiped, he's worshiped at the same level as God the Father. There is no distinction in the worship between the two. The actions are the same. The words are the same. The accompanying of all the worship, there's no difference in degree. There's no difference in the type. There's no difference in the words. And this tells us a whole lot about Jesus, that he is indeed God and he is worthy of our worship. So can we worship Jesus? Absolutely, we should be, because the angels are, and we can join in that, because we certainly will be when we get to heaven together. So here's some key things to remember from chapters 4 and 5. God is on the throne. Nothing is outside of his control, even though it will look and feel like this is not the case. When the Antichrist is doing his antichristy things, it will feel horrible. And in the days leading up to it, these events, these disasters that will happen will feel like the world is running out of control, but we see the Lamb opening them. And again, you can watch that video on the next 3 on chapter 6. And get that sense that it's Jesus who is setting the events in motion. We see also that God is eternal. He is directing the events of time. God is the creator. He is more powerful than any creature, including the dragon, who is Satan, and the beast, who is the Antichrist. 4, God has already determined how everything will be resolved. And we see that in the scroll. The final chapter is already written. So it's not any surprise to God. Maybe surprising to us, but not to him. And we can have full faith and confidence in him, knowing that he's in the driver's seat. He's taking us to the ultimate destination. Maybe a bumpy ride, but we will get there and we will be fine. No one can alter how things will end, nor initiate the end or alter or any kind of alternate ending. Maybe you've seen movies with How It Should Have Ended or an alternate ending on there. There is no alternate ending to the book of Revelation. That's the way things are going to play out, and it will be difficult, but there's victory in the end. There's joy in the end, and nobody can change that. Not the World Economic Forum, not any of your favorite supervillain who lives today, Klaus Schwab or Bill Gates or whoever you want to put into that category of super wicked people that are messing with the world today. None of them can alter the ending or create an alternate ending. And then 5, Jesus overcame. This is 6. Jesus overcame by being faithful unto death, and we will overcome in the same way. We die to self. If anyone wants to be a disciple of Jesus, he must die to himself, pick up his cross daily, and follow him. It's a picture of dying to ourselves. We die to the world. We die to sin. And maybe, if it calls for it, we die physically for the sake of his name. And certainly, in the rest of Revelation, this is what will be the fate of many saints. Not all, but many. And even today, in the time of general tribulation, this is the fate of some. It does not mean that they are not favored by God. It means that they are highly favored, and we talk about that more. So if you got any questions or comments, I'd love to hear that. Drop that in the comments below. Make sure you subscribe, like, and share. And most of all, thanks for watching. I appreciate you hanging out with me all the way to the end. Pray that God will richly bless you. And as always, Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. Amen and amen.